students, welcome to the lecture on menu and pricing considerations. And after this lecture, we will be able to learn the following objectives. Explain the types of budgets. Describe pricing considerations. Discuss menu pricing. Define menu engineering. Today, with the continual increases in the costs of food, beverages, labor, energy, maintenance, and other overheads, most establishments operate some form of budgetary control. A budget is a plan expressed usually in the financial and or quantitative terms which reflects the policies of an establishment and determines the business operations of 1 year, but is often broken down into review periods of either 13 hour week periods or alternatively of 13 week quarters, each quarter consisting of 2 hour week and 1 5-week periods. The term budgetary control refers to a method of control where particular responsibility for various budgeted results is assigned to the managers concerned, and a continuous comparison of the actual results and budgeted figures is made. The objectives of budgetary control are three-bid: to provide a plan of action for a set trading period, to guide and regulate a business in keeping with its stated policies, and to maximize the full use of its resources. To set standards of performance for management against which their performance can be measured. To set out levels of cost responsibility and encourage cost awareness. Let us now discuss some types of budgets. There are various kinds of budgets that are used in food and beverage operations. Basically, there are two main types: capital budgets, operating budgets. Capital budgets, as the name implies, are those which are concerned with the assets and liabilities of an establishment. For example, equipment, plant, and cash. Operating budgets. Those are concerned with the day-to-day income and expenditure of an establishment and include sales, cost of sales, labor maintenance, head office expenses, etc. The breakdown of the restaurant budget identifies further the specific standards of performance required of the restaurant management. When this is set against the recorded actual performance for that period, the performance achieved can be measured. It is the usual practice to show not only the actual and budget information for a period but also the cumulative information for the year to date. The cumulative figures give a smoothing effect to any irregularities in performance of past periods as well as the overall picture of performance for the year so far. Basic stages in the preparation of budgets. Budgeting may be seen as being in 6 stages. Determination of the net profit required for the business in relation to the capital invested and the risk involved. Preparation of the sales budget determines the volume of sales necessary to achieve the desired net profit or subsidy and also influences the budgeted costs for food, beverages, labor, and some overheads. Preparation of administration and general budgets. These are for such items as head office expenses, advertising rates, insurance, etc. Preparation of the capital expenditure budget, which makes provision for such items of expenditure as new kitchen equipment, restaurant and bar furniture, including any installation charges, etc. Preparation of the cash budget. This is regarded as the most important of the capital budgets and it predetermines the cash inflows, the cash outflows and resulting cash balance at particular points during the period. Preparation of master budgets. As stated previously, master budgets are prepared for the trading account, profit and loss account, and the balance sheet. Welfare operations. The fact that food and beverage operations in the welfare sector, for example, a hospital dining room or an employee restaurant, may not be required to make a profit in the same way that commercial restaurants are, and that they may receive some form of subsidy, does not make budgeting any less necessary. when food and beverages are being sold at or near cost prices or are being prepared within very strict subsidy cost limits, it is even more necessary that costs be estimated very accurately than where there is a large gross profit margin, which can absorb some errors in costing. Costs, profits, and sales. The elements of cost. The cost of operating a catering unit or department is usually analyzed under the three headings of material costs, cost of food and beverage consumed, and the cost of additional items such as tobacco. The cost of any food and beverage provided to staff in the form of meals is deducted from material costs and added to labor costs. The food cost is then calculated by the formula: opening stock plus cost of purchases minus closing stock minus cost of staff meals is equal to material cost. Labor costs, wages and salaries paid to all employees plus any employer contribution to government taxes, bonuses, staff meals, pension fund, etc. Overhead costs, all costs other than material and labor costs, for example, rent, rates, insurance, depreciation, repairs, printing and stationery, china and glassware, capital equipment. Cost groups. It is necessary to examine costs not only by their nature, material, labor, overheads, but also by their behavior in relation to changes in the volume of sales. Using this criteria, costs may be intensified as being of four kinds. Fixed costs. These are costs which remain fixed irrespective of the volume of sales, for example, rent, rates, insurance, the management element of labor costs. Semi-fixed costs. These are costs which move in sympathy with but not in direct proportion to the volume of sales. Variable costs. These are costs which vary in proportion to the volume of sales, for example, food and beverage. Total costs. This is the sum of the fixed costs, semi-fixed costs, and variable costs involved. Profit. Three main kinds of profit are normally referred to in food and beverage operations. Gross profit is equal to total sales minus cost of materials. After wage profit or net margin is equal to total sales minus material plus labor costs. Net profit is equal to total sales minus total costs, material plus labor plus overhead costs. Break-even analysis. It is very common for food and beverage management to be faced with problems concerning the level of food and beverage cost that can be afforded, the prices that need to be set for food and beverages, the level of profit required at departmental and unit level, and the number of customers required to cover specific costs or to make a certain level of profit. Typical questions raised are, what level of sales is needed to cover the fixed costs of a unit? What level of sales is required from a particular unit to achieve INR X's net profit? What level of sales is required to increase the net profit of a unit by INR 9,90,000? What will be the effect of increasing prices by 5% have on net profit? What will be the effect on net profit of increasing the average speed of customers by 50 paise per meal? Answers to these types of questions are normally attempted by using the accepted technique of break-even analysis. Break-even analysis enables the relationship between fixed, semi-fixed and variable costs at specific volumes of business to be conveniently represented on a graph. This enables the break-even point to be identified and the level of sales necessary to produce a predetermined level of net profit. The term break-even point may be defined as that volume of business at which the total costs are equal to the sales and where neither profit nor loss is made. The technique is based on the assumption that the selling price remains constant irrespective of the volume of business, that certain unit costs remain the same over the sales range of the charted period, that only one product, for example a meal, is being made or sold that the product mix remains constant in cost price and volume, and that labor and machine productivity is constant. Nearly every action or planned decision in a business will affect the costs, prices to be charged, the volume of business and the profit. Profits depend on the balance of the selling prices, the mix of products, the costs and the volume of business. The break-even technique discloses the interplay of all these factors in a way which aids food and beverage management in selecting the best course of action now and in the future.
This is Farmer Joe. He grows apples. And this is investment banker John Parker from Goldman Sachs.
Good day to you, sir.
Howdy, partner.
Farmer Joe, have you ever heard of the break-even point?
Well, I don't care about a fancy thing called the break-even point. All I want to know is how many apples I have to sell to make money with my business.
Well, that's exactly what the break-even point is for, Farmer Joe. So, are you interested in it?
Yeah, for sure. Tell me more about it.
Alright then. So, first of all, we need to know how much do you charge for an apple?
I charge $1 for an apple.
Do you eventually know what the production costs of one apple are?
Well, a fancy guy like you used to do that math for me. He told me that I spend 50 cents an apple for diesel, pesticides, and labor. But I don't know if I would trust the Harvard guy.
Eh, whatever. So, these are your variable costs per apple. Variable means that if you don't crop any apples, you would have no variable costs. Is that clear to you?
Yeah, of course. I'm not dumb. I don't need pesticides or diesel if I don't crop any apples. But what about my tractors?
Yeah, we will come to that issue right now. Overheads are, for example, depreciation of your tractor, interests of your bank loans, and other expenses like insurance and, of course, office workers. These are your fixed costs. You have to deal with them no matter whether you crop 1 million apples or just 5.
Ah, that sounds reasonable. According to my financial guy, I have $25,000 in overheads. So tell me, where is my break-even point?
Well, Farmer Joe, in general, when you want to get your break-even point, you have to take all your overheads and divide them by the contribution margin per unit. The contribution margin is the difference between your selling price and the variable cost.
Boring! Why don't you just tell me, in numbers, how many apples I do have to sell?
Oh, excuse me, sir, I will come to that right now. In your case, you've got $25,000 of overheads. And you divide them by a contribution margin of 50 cents. You get this contribution margin because you sell one apple for $1. And you have variable costs of 50 cents for one apple. And when you do all the fancy math, the break-even point equals 50,000 apples. And so, Farmer Joe, you have to sell 50,000 apples to reach your break-even point and to break even.
Whoa, wait a minute. Tell me, how on earth should I possibly sell 50,000 apples a year? What could we do to break even a little earlier? Let's say with 25,000 apples.
Interesting question, Mr. Joe. You see that three figures have an impact on the break-even point. And these figures are the selling price, your variable costs per unit, and your overheads. You could reach your break-even point earlier if you would raise, for example, your price, let's say by 20%. Then you make $1.20 per apple. So, let's see when you break even now.
So, that means I break even at about 36,000 apples? Well, that's not enough. There's gotta be something we can do about this.
Hmm, Let me think. Well, I'm sure you could work more efficiently and decrease your variable costs per apple to, let's say, about 40 cents per apple. Therefore, you would break even at 31,250 apples.
Well, that already looks way better to me, but I think there's still some room, isn't it?
Yeah, last but not least, we could try to decrease your fixed costs. Let us talk with the bank and insurances. Maybe we can fix a deal and decrease them to about $20,000? Then we could break even at 25,000 apples.
Well, that would be great. Thank you very much, fancy business guy.
My pleasure, Farmer Joe. It is not only my job to run around in fields and explain business terms to farmers like you. It is also my passion. You're welcome, my friends. You're very, very welcome.
Let us now move further and talk about pricing considerations. The pricing of a product has to meet the objectives of an organization, and aspects related to pricing will normally be found in the financial, marketing, and catering policies. For example, within the financial policy of a commercial organization, the basic aim of profit to be made in relation to the capital invested will be stated. The financial policy for an establishment in the welfare sector would state the level of subsidy to be allocated to the catering department and how it was to be calculated. The approach to pricing will differ not only between the major sectors of the industry, where normally in the non-commercial sector pricing is cost-oriented, and in the commercial sector pricing is usually market-oriented, but also between organizations within these sectors. Pricing based on cost. The traditional method used to establish the price of a menu item is to calculate, ideally from a standard recipe, the food cost per unit of the particular item and to add a given percentage of gross profit to arrive at the selling price. The percentage of gross profit applied should be sufficient to cover the fixed cost element, for example, rent, rates, etc., and payroll costs. The semi-fixed element, for example, heating, telephones, etc., and a satisfactory element of net profit. Pricing based on the market. The relationship between price and value for money is an important aspect of pricing. Value for money extends way beyond just the cost of the ingredients or the items chosen from a menu by a customer. The whole meal experience has to be taken into account, including such things as the atmosphere, decor, choice of menu items, level of service offered, etc. In order to be successful and to achieve a satisfactory volume of sales, pricing has to consider three basic factors. The nature of the demand for the product. The economic concept of the elasticity of demand is relevant here. Elasticity of demand is the sensitivity of the sales volume to changes in price. A product would be said to have an elastic demand when a small decrease in the price charged would bring a significant increase in sales, or alternatively, if a small increase would bring about a significant decrease in sales. The level of the demand for the product. It is typical of most catering operations that they experience a fluctuating demand for their product, not only hourly, example as seen clearly in fast food operations, but daily, example in many hotel restaurants which on some days in the week have a low customer throughput. This fluctuation of demand normally affects their volume of sales and results in the underutilization of the premises, staff, etc., highlighting the necessity for a flexible approach to be given to pricing. The level of the competition for the product. Competition is a factor, as much as the product cost and market demand, in determining selling prices. Competition exists from not only similar type operations, but also from dissimilar operations. As in most instances, customers are free to choose where they go and what amount they spend. Let us now study about menu price in detail. Menu price are defined as departmental profit margins. The approach to menu pricing must follow from the outline of the basic policies and from the determined departmental profit targets. Each department will have a significant role in the total organization, and its individual profit targets will normally be unrelated. Differential profit margins. It is unusual to apply a uniform rate of gross profit to all of the items found on a food menu or beverage list, although this simplistic method of costing can at times still be found in the non-commercial sector of the industry. In the non-commercial sector of the industry, one of the advantages is that where a uniform rate of gross profit is applied, for example 60%, reference to the takings can quickly show the costs at 40% gross profit irrespective of the sales mix, and an immediate comparison can be made to the actual usage of materials. It ignores such things as capital investment, it emphasizes the cost too much, it ignores competition, etc.
Once you have your menu planned, you need to spend some time thinking about the menu price points. It's important to remember you have only one chance to make a last impression. And the pricing of your restaurant will be the last thing, the last taste in your guest's mouth as they leave. They will have just signed the check, and they're going to make a judgment. Was it worth what it cost me? And then they're going to be reminded of that if they paid by credit card when their credit card bill arrives. And they're going to say, was that worth it? So you need to remember the value proposition. It's not what you spend, it's what you get for what you spend. What you should have as your goal is that when someone pays for their meal, they say, wow, that was amazing. I would have even paid more. What you don't want is for them to get the bill and say, really? That's what I'm paying for what just happened? They're never coming back. Think long and hard about your price points. They're part of a relationship with your guest that you want to continue. Menu price points have a profound impact on your business. You need to think about, first, does it fit my business? People know when they spend money on food in a restaurant that they're not just buying the food. They're also paying for the entire staff of the restaurant, the air conditioning, the electrical bill, the garbage removal, the flowers, the printed materials. They're paying for all of that. So when they look at a price on a menu, they say, does this fit the entire experience I'm getting? Does it match up with the feeling and idea of this restaurant? So the first thing you need to determine is what price points match the experience that you're delivering to your guest. The next thing you might want to do is decide what style of service will I provide in this restaurant. Is it counter service? Is it table service? Is it very high level waiter, captain, busboy service? How something is delivered will determine how much value it has to the guest. Also, what it's delivered on. Are you going to deliver this food on a paper plate? The prices better be very reasonable. If you're going to bring it on beautiful china, you can charge a bit more. So once you've decided how this restaurant menu pricing is going to match your restaurant and how it feels, you also need to consider the cost of each particular item. Now, most people understand that chicken will be cheaper than beef, which will be cheaper than lobster. There are some surprises in there that you need to watch. Sometimes those specialty greens that you get from the farmer who comes to the green market in your area actually cost a lot more on the plate than the protein. It's very important when you're trying to price a specific dish that you know how much it costs. That's what's called your food cost. And your food cost is a vital part of the financial success of your business. So you need to really work with your team to determine exactly how much that plate costs to deliver, to produce, and to put on a plate. Then you know how much you may have to charge for that dish. You also might have to make some difficult decisions and decide that dish is just too expensive to produce. How can we make it a great value? Another important thing to consider in menu planning in terms of pricing is what's called the sales mix. You don't sell the same number of every item. Some items are best sellers, some you sell a moderate amount of, and some you just sell a few of. And the things you sell more of have a more profound impact proportionally on your profitability. So when you're thinking about pricing, you have to use it to work with your sales mix so that the entire revenue works for your food cost.
Menu pricing applications. Sales tax. Depending on the government and power, it is likely that some form of sales tax may be enforced during its period of office. It is important to the customer to know whether prices displayed or quoted are inclusive of this sales tax or not. Service charge. This is an additional charge made to customers at a fixed percentage of the total cost of the food and beverage served. The fixed percentage is determined by management, printed on the menu beverage list, with the objective of removing from the customer the problem of determining what size of tip to give when in a particular establishment. As this charge is to be distributed to the staff at a later date, usually on a point system, it should be treated similarly to a sales tax and not included in the calculation of revenue for food and beverages or in the calculations of average spend. Cover charge. This is an additional charge to a meal in restaurants to cover such costs as the bread roll and butter and items included but not priced on a menu. Care should be exercised as to whether to implement this or not, as it is most likely to cause aggravation to some clients when it is applied. Minimum charge. This is often enforced by restaurants to discourage some potential clients from using the premises and to discourage clients from taking up a seat and only purchasing a very low priced item. The exact method of pricing used by an establishment will depend on such matters as which sector of the industry the establishment is in, the level of profit subsidy required, its basic policies, etc. Table D hot menus. The type of menus is characterized by being a restricted menu offering a small range of courses with a limited choice within each course and at a fixed selling price. The price may be just one price for any three courses chosen, or may vary in price depending on the main course chosen. The method of pricing chosen should take into account the departmental profit required and the differential profit margins of the menu. A la carte menus. This type of menu is characterized by being a larger menu than table d'hôte menu, offering a greater choice of courses and dishes within each course and each item being individually priced. The method of pricing here is again to take into account the departmental profit required and the differential profit margins for each course and then to price each item separately using standard recipes. Banqueting menus. This is a specific type of table d'hôte menu offering normally no choice to the customers. The specific difference in pricing this menu is that apart from the food and often the liquor, all the additional items are normally priced and charged separately. Examples of such items are flowers for each table, a band, meals and refreshments for the band, services of a toastmaster, hire of a microphone, printing of a special menu for the function. The pricing of a banquet menu for a client is commonly found to have a flexible element to it, in that it is not uncommon for a banqueting manager to offer additions to a menu at no additional cost to the client in order to obtain the business during a slack trading period or a particular gap in a week. Pricing of beverages. The method used to price beverages is similar to that for pricing foods. As in the case of foods, first the departmental profit target and gross profit percentage should be set, followed by differential profit margins based on the sales mix achievable. The sales mix breakdown depends on the type of operation and how detailed the breakdown of sales is required. Pricing may be more accurately calculated for beverages as little, if any, processing of the drinks takes place. Drinks being purchased by the bottle, for example, beer, wine, or by a specific stated measure. For example, 6 out from a bottle of known standard size, for example, wine, 75 cal. The mixing of drinks is like food, usually prepared using a standard recipe particular to an establishment. Profit improvement, maintaining and improving an adequate level of profit are essential for all businesses today to survive, particularly with the increasing level of competition, tempting customers not only to change from their usual type of restaurant, but also from the many other types of leisure businesses, all chasing the same customers' restricted amount of disposable income. Two accepted methods of profit improvement are profit sensitivity analysis and menu engineering. Profit sensitivity analysis, PSA, is concerned with identifying the critical or key factors, that is, the determinants of profitability of a business, and establishing how they rank in influencing its net profit. The emphasis of PSA is on net profit and the examination of those areas that responded positively to change. In order to undertake PSA, the profit multipliers of the business must firstly be calculated. The method is identify the key factors, financial and operational, of the business. Assume a change in one key factor at a time of say 10% whilst holding all others constant. Calculate the resulting change in net profit. Calculate the profit multipliers, PM. PM is equal to percentage in change in net profit, percentage in key factors. The PMs in order of size. Analyze the results. Let us discuss about menu engineering now. Menu engineering is a marketing-oriented approach to the evaluation of a menu with regard to its present and future content, design, and pricing. Its origins are based on the famous Boston Consulting Group, BCG. Portfolio technique, a matrix specifically designed to analyze individual business performance in a company with a range of different business interests. The concept of menu engineering requires food and beverage managers to orient themselves to the contribution that menu items make to the total profitability of a menu. It highlights the good and the poor performers in a menu and provides vital information for making the menu more interesting and appealing to the customers and hopefully more profitable. Menu engineering is a step-by-step procedure that focuses on the three main elements. Customer demand, the number of customers served, menu mix and analysis of customer preferences for each menu item, popularity, contribution margin, an analysis of the contribution margin GP percent for each menu item. Prerequisites. The prerequisites to using this technique are the standardization of all recipes including the presentation so that the food costs can be accurate. The accurate sales analysis of each menu item daily and by meal period. The use of a personal computer so that simple spreadsheets with standard calculations may be done accurately and with speed. Using the simple matrix, menu items can be plotted, represented their performance with regard to volume, popularity, and cash contribution profit. The four squares of the matrix commonly have names indicating the performance of items in a particular square. Stars. Menu items high in menu mix, popularity, and also high in contribution margin. Plow horses. Menu items high in menu mix, popularity, but low in contribution margin. Puzzles. Menu items low in menu mix, popularity, and high in contribution margin. The meat tag. In the majority of catering establishments, such items of food as meat, special processed meats, such as hams and fish, such as smoked salmon, constitute the most expensive of the purchased foods. Because of this high cost, it is not uncommon for units operating a detailed control system to set up a form of special control of these items. Now, in the end, let us summarize what we have learnt in this lecture. A master budgeted trading account for a particular trading period showing the predetermined volume of sales, the cost of sales and the gross profit expected. Preparation of the sales budget determines the volume of sales necessary to achieve the desired net profit or subsidy, and also influences the budgeted costs for food, beverages, labor, and some overheads. Break-even analysis enables the relationship between fixed, semi-fixed, and variable costs at specific volumes of business to be conveniently represented on a graph. Profits depend on the balance of the selling prices, the mix of products, the costs, and the volume of business. The pricing of a product has to meet the objectives of an organization, and aspects related to pricing will normally be found in the financial, marketing, and catering policies.